taking on from the earlier chapter, he has looked at the average economic profits in the steel industry, 78-96 at that time. And just quickly read the names. On the higher side, Great Northern Iron, Worthington Industries, Nucor, which is also an iron company, Steel Technologies, Oregon Mills, Commercial Metals, and so on. Then goes British Steel, it's losing money. Cleveland something, Quanex, Lucas, you don't even know because these companies don't exist today actually. So, Acme Metals, Amco, US Steel, US Steel used to be huge, doesn't exist today. England Steel, Amco, WH, Bethlehem. Bethlehem doesn't exist today. Rather much. Now, this is about the steel industry. Now, what is the main point here? This is basically in the US and Europe. That is one of the issues with all these conceptual courses and so on. So now I will urge you that henceforth you should connect these things within the agenda. Right? Then you will be able to connect it better. In this case, supposing I ask which one is the mini steel mill, you will not know instinctively, but Nucor is. And Nucor is one of the most profitable. How many of you remember, and also what were the number of mini steel mills in the 70s and 70s? 70s plus 80s. How many mini steel mills are there? And how many of them survived? See, this is the issue. That is why analyses are also required. You will not be able to position how and where NJSW came from, unless you go back to the school. They also started in India. All of them started in India to melt the scrap, and all of them will be ready to do it. All of them prospered, relatively speaking, for a while, and all of them closed their doors. So here it is that when you are doing competitive analysis, you have to look at how the industry is going on average. The other day we said pharmaceutical makes a lot of money, but still doesn't make that money. But within that industry, there is a variation. And why the variation is there? This is about positioning. Any of the mills which have survived, steel mills which have survived in Europe and US today, especially, and get much, much higher percentage of value added. So more expensive. If commodity steel, they are. And they used to be very expensive. US steel itself used to manufacture 80 million tons. 80 kg. That's the difference. So, anytime, please do go to the history of the industry. Please look at its cost structure, how it is built. But within that cost structure of the industry, the averages which we get, there will be a variation. This is in the drug industry. Now you make the comment on it. Can you read it? Get it? Glaxo. SmithKline is on the top, followed by Glaxo, followed by American Home Products. And then you hear of those names, right? Because they produce still survive. Perhaps SmithKline and some others have merged. But Glaxo, yeah. Which also tells you, it's like marriages. It's the like and the like who get together. People who are struggling, they'll also get together for some reason, you know, getting SIs, so reducing certain costs, doing marketing together, and so on. Because when you're reducing the size, your incidence of fixed cost, as it applies for your starts costing, your logistics become expensive. So we will very soon talk about in which way do you look at the cost. Not how an accountant will look at it, but how a managerial person will look at it. Some of them are in newer technologies like GenTech, which will take on. But for many years, if they just go on these 20%, 30% kind of negative returns, nobody will find them and they'll be out. So within this pharmaceutical industry, which is supposed to be earning, which is the industry which earns the highest profits, any industrial sector, you get the data. There is such a wide variation within.
Sir,
Yeah.
Why are you always, this trend is decreasing as opposed to increasing? The average industry equity is increasing, the spread is decreasing.
It just so happens that these happen to be in this particular industry. These happen to be industries which have been set up for quite some time. And this is like the invested equity in old times. This question you ask when you look at Microsoft and Apple and all, how much money did they need really to while on the right side, many of the companies like the Genentech and all that are the new technologies that are higher. Now, it's an inverse correlation, which is counterintuitive. Also, what you're saying is that it is not the invested capital which is going to make them profitable. It is good products and this is the marketplace.
But
the
economy
is
getting
more
equity.
Yeah, so it is at a particular point of time, which is not bad, it's an 18 years spread. So if you look at even in a very selective fashion, out the rest, what has happened in 2010, right? The picture will become clear. Some would have been completely thrown out. Some would have become bigger. And those who have become bigger, you look at what the strategy is having, both in terms of product and market.
Sir, are these companies investing in research and development more?
Looks like, yeah.
Rather than...
instinctively, I'm telling you, Genentech, ICN, Srenner, designs, they were all in new technologies. Gensia also, new technologies. Cygnus, Luminix, new technologies.
Sir, were they subsidiaries of any of the technologies?
No, they are independent standing companies. Otherwise, they will be part of the subsidiary. These are independent companies.
But it's over 18 years, so that might have returned them some
profit. It's over 18 years, but a lot of this phenomena has taken place in the 90s.
Sir, but initially...
Oh, you might get... I am in that industry. It is a one-time shot snapshot I'm taking, right? So I will take this one-time snapshot. You take another one-time snapshot in 2000, right? But here the minimal point is that while we say that the pharmaceutical industry is the most profitable industry in the world, within that there is a lot of variation. So true, certain companies would be relatively decent and all that, so you can give them a couple of years. But there also I'm saying if the losing 40% of the equity, right? The investor will say, by 1998, either you survive or you do something or you go. It's another percentage. So there is a lot of money which has gone into the bank industry down the line also. R&D is risky. After the R&D, getting a product approval to launch is a very long process. That's also kept in place. Clinical trials and so on. And then, after launching, the established company is not making it happen pretty quickly.